I would like to gratefully acknowledge the panel who has found our paper worthy of presentation at this conference, the organizers, the MIT ADT University host for this event, fantastic effort in putting this PuneCon 2021 together with such rich agenda, and also a long list of very esteemed and knowledgeable subject matter experts to talk on several matters. I have great honor in presenting today a paper on a novel concept, a novel approach on bioeconomy and industry 5.0 enhanced vision with my colleague, Dr. Bhushan Kelkar. The paper is authored by Dr. Pramod Chaudhary, who is the founder and chairman of Praj, and also co-authored by Dr. Bhushan, myself, and my colleague Prasanna Borse. So over next 20 minutes, it will be our pleasure to walk you through the presentation. If I can go to the next slide, it actually briefly introduces you about our company, Praj Industries Limited, which is India's most accomplished industrial biotechnology company. The statistics speak for themselves, but the couple of points I want to highlight here is the award that you see, which is a George Washington Carver Award, the highest award in the industrial biotechnology globally, given to an individual who have done outstanding contributions in the area of agriculture, technology, innovation, and entrepreneurship. Dr. Pramod Chaudhary, the founder chairman of the Praj, became the first Indian recipient of this award in the year 2020. The legacy he has put in by way of Praj for over four decades is also visible from the fact that Praj is recognized as the best place to work in the global bioeconomy, and also second hottest and third hottest company in some of the respective criteria. Moving on to the next slide, what I will request is my colleague Dr. Bhushan to walk you through some of the basic concepts of industrial revolution.
Right. Yeah, thanks, Dr. Ravindra. So next few slides, I'm going to be introducing what is Industry 4.0, and then building on that, what we are proposing as Industry 5.0. Yeah. So we are going to cover a lot of concepts in here, and I'll be covering that in about 6 or 7 slides. Quickly running through this particular slide, just to give the background. Naturally, if we are talking about Industry 5.0, there must have been Industry 1 to 4, and there indeed have been. Industry 1.0 started really in 1784. We all know with the James Watt steam engine, weaving looms, etc. About 100 years later, we are into Industry 2.0, which is mass production, assembly lines, electrical energy, and then yet another 100 years we are witnessing Industry 3.0 in the history of evolution, and that really was demarcated by the idea of automation, computers, and electronics. And you will see that the epochs have been separated by about 100 years, and they are also color-coded to be gray, and the reason is that these three revolutions, India was either not independent politically, or we were not a very important superpower, financial superpower. And Industry 4.0 is very different. It started 40 years after Industry 3.0 advent. Industry 4.0 hence is also blue in color, and it is very different because India is not only as a country, is not only independent, but also we are a recognized financial power. So Industry 4.0 is culmination of cyber and physical systems together, which were earlier separate. It involves a lot of things. In fact, I will tell you what are the building blocks of Industry 4.0, but things that we generally keep hearing about is Internet of Things and various kinds of networks, artificial intelligence, big data. So that's really something that you will see in the next slide. And this slide, I am presenting a very typical mind map. Many of you might be very well aware of this concept. And you will see that there are 9 main branches of Industry 4.0. What is important to remember is Industry 4.0 is not a single technology. It is in fact a confluence of 9 components. It is also important to remember that these 9 components have evolved at different times, and hence logically they are at different maturity stage. So if we look at, for example, simulation, that is one of the things that we are all very very clearly aware. We have been doing it since our school days. A lot of simulations we have done, and that is one of the building blocks. Then you have robotics, which we are aware of in terms of drones. There is industrial robots, there are various other bots and chatbots and so on. So we are aware of this technology. Another one is IoT, and as we close on 2021, 22 and 23 will really open up a lot of doors for us in terms of opportunities in IoT because of the advent of 5G. We keep hearing about that, and it really encompasses connectivity and communication and a lot of other well-known terms such as IoP, IIoT and RFID and Bluetooth. So that's another branch. The fourth branch is something that we are heavily using in marketing and entertainment, and that pertains to augmented reality, virtual reality, what is also known as hybrid reality and mixed reality and so on. Then we have cyber security, which is blockchain and algorithms. Then we have cloud. And of course, we are using cloud right now to deliver this session. So this is not something new to us. We also have 3D printing, and we have big data, and the 5 classic V's which define big data come together for a voluminous data to be called big data. All of this is really glued together by the artificial intelligence techniques, and then we have neural networks and many other components. So that's really the entire spectrum of Industry 4.0. Now, building on that, Industry 5 version 1 and 2 have come about. Industry 5 version 1 really builds onto the robotics branch of the 9 branches, and it gives a kahani mein twist in it, and that is humans working alongside robots is called cobots, and that is picking up quite fast. And it's a very simple idea there. All the transactional roles would be done by robots, and all the transformational roles would be done by humans. And when they work in tandem, they work seamlessly and they work in harmony, hopefully, it is cobots. So that's something that is modification and building onto the robots branch of Industry 5.0, and hence we have changed the color as well. Version 2, which sort of parallelly evolved, and we will see that historic evolution. But bioeconomy is the version 2. And now this encompasses white biotechnology, bionics, synthetic biology. Synthetic biology really would mean biocircuits. It also would mean CRISPR-Cas9 technology that was awarded Nobel Prize recently. And all the protein synthesis and stuff like that is very central to synthetic biology. You might have even read something very interesting recently about xenobots, and that also falls in the realm of synthetic biology, where you are controlling the evolution, biological evolution process using computers. So that is bioeconomy version 2. Now, this is already here, and what we are going to present is a step beyond these two. And obviously, there is a reason why we are presenting a different vision. So let me take you to the next slide, and also introduce you to a new term which you may not have heard of. Some of you might be aware of it, but if you look at the overall evolution of humans as a race, then there is a new term called Society 5.0, which got introduced in Japan. And so this Japanese way really started describing the evolution in terms of society as a word and a phrase, and this got introduced in 2016, Society 5.0. But what is society 1 to 4? Society 1 is hunting society, 2 is agrarian society, 3 is industrial society, 4th is information society, and the last one, the most recent one, is super smart society. Now, how it maps onto the other industrial revolutions terms that we saw is something that we are seeing here. Industry 1 and 2 would culminate in society 3.0 time-wise and function-wise. As the complexity increases, industry 3.0 and 4.0 together would culminate into society 4.0. And also society 5.0 building onto industry 4.0. Now, industry 5.0, I already described to you, the future really belongs here, and you will see an interesting pattern. Between industry 3 and 4, we said that the time epoch was only 40 years. And now we are seeing industry 5, already version 1, 2, and the one that we are presenting, is happening right around 2020-21, which is hardly a decade. So you can see that not only we are advancing, but the rate of change is also very high. So this is just giving you a perspective as to how society 5.0, which is a relatively new term, and the backdrop of industry 1 to 4 are the precursors of industry 5 version 1 and 2 and the one that we are trying to present. So why is there a need of industry 5 enhanced version? What is lacking in versions 1 and 2, which is, again, I'm trying to remind, that is the cobot theory and also the bioeconomy based industry 5.0. The first important reason where the enhanced version is necessary, we felt, is the ecological aspect. There is a lot of impact and effort in the direction of enhancing the output, but there is very little conscious effort in preserving nature, thinking about, you know, COP conferences, thinking about carbon footprint, thinking about net zero, thinking about a lot of stuff which really is very, very central to very existence of human race. And so this part of ecological balance seems to be missing, or at least it is not as significant as one would hope. And with that as one of the reasons, you are seeing something on the right side, and that right side is an inverted tetrahedron, and we are trying to build this as a depiction of what we are trying to evolve and present. On the three apexes of the base triangle of this inverted tetrahedron, you have cyber physical systems, cobots, and quantum mechanics or mechanisms, which are evolving on one side. This is the industry 4 and industry 5 version 1. So this is the cobot version of industry 5.0. On the right hand side, you have bioeconomy and ecology, which is a very important aspect, and that in itself is version 2 of industry 5.0. And we feel that these two, while are advances in terms of stability and in general human happiness, there is something centrally missing in that, and that is human-centric development, which is socially and even culturally inclusive. So this piece seems to be missing, and that is where our the position paper, if we can call it, of enhanced version of industry 5.0 really stems from. So the first aspect that we are trying to solve here is ecological aspect. So the cyber physical systems or version 1 and bioeconomy version 2 are there. But in ecological system aspects, we are also looking at inclusive growth. Next up is sustainability, which should not take you by surprise. There is huge requirement, and waste management are key areas which are not again considered. What you are considering is efficiency, you are considering is impact in terms of profitability and so on. Speed with which you are creating products and services and reaching out to your intended customers. All of this is very much happening efficiently, but the sustainability, which is energy management and waste management, are rather ignored. So this is yet another point that we focus on in terms of enhanced version. We are also talking about unemployment and human costs. And I can really be talking about this for hours together, but unemployment as we know it, with Industrial Revolution 1-4 was already a threat. And with unfortunate advent of COVID-19 and many other things which are happening in last couple of years, this has only sped up the issue of unemployment, especially because of the automation in variety of fields and not limiting only to IT and manufacturing. And so unemployment is a massive threat and it can lead to civil unrest. There is already a lot of discussion talk at the United Nations level as well. And in fact, things that you might have heard of, like universal basic income or robot tax, are also outcomes of this debate and a very important aspect. The second last point is psychological impact. There is no purpose of life as is felt by a lot of people in society. And if there is no purpose, the fun part of the life would be lost, and also the spiritual part of the society would be lost. And there are indeed mental health issues. In fact, UK has constituted a ministry of loneliness, and there are other countries, including Japan, who have followed suit. As if this is not enough, the last point, also important point, ever-widening gap between the haves and have-nots, rural and urban, and many other types of divides are there. And unfortunately, the gap is only widening. Now, these areas, very important five areas, are really not being covered by Industry 4 or Industry 5 version 1 or version 2, and hence the need for Industry 5 enhanced version, and that is what we are really presenting. Industry 4, 5 version 1 and 2 and Society 5.0 are compared in this table, and you can read this at your leisure. I know it's a busy slide, but really Industry 5.0, the one that we are talking about and focusing and proposing, is about equilibrium of not only cyber-physical systems, which are admittedly and beyond shadow of doubt efficient, but they are not taking care of inclusivity and ecology at the same time, which we are. So the motivation is smart society, but not stopping there, and about inclusive growth. And then the other details are already given here. So that is the real precursor to what is enhanced version of Industry 5.0. This is the need, and we already are presenting a position paper on that. So to take you through the details of this, I would again turn it back to my very able colleague, and he can talk about what is the economy and take it further from here. Over to you, Ravindra.
Yeah, Bhushan, thanks. I mean, that was a wonderful illustration of how industry evolution has happened and how it has contributed to mankind progress, lifting the below poverty level, I mean, the poverty level line going up, a lot of people coming up. As we all know, energy is the growth driver for the progress. What is in question is, however, the sources of energy. And recently concluded COP26 summit at Glasgow called for clarion calls over climate action. And as the industry revolution takes into the next gear, where quotes are soon going to become a reality, there is an eternal element of sustainability and sustainable climate action that is coming in. And that's where bioeconomy comes in. You know, what we are showing in this slide, it is to your left-hand side, a circular bioeconomy concept. We all know that plants absorb carbon dioxide for photosynthesis. And then goods and products made from plants, when consumed, emit carbon dioxide. So on one hand, you are absorbing carbon dioxide. On the other hand, you are emitting carbon dioxide. So in a way, what you're doing is creating a carbon neutral cycle, and which is the whole essence of a bioeconomy. If it is not carbon neutral, it definitely is a low carbon cycle. So actually, the raw material comes in the form of agricultural waste, biomass, bio-based feedstock. It undergoes the biochemical, biothermal processing using the state-of-the-art innovative technologies. And then what you have is various goods and products in the form of fuels, in the form of renewable chemicals, in the form of biomanure. And all these products, when consumed, actually go back to Mother Earth. So what we are saying here is we are talking about a bioeconomy that is based on carbohydrates. Carbohydrates as a source of energy, carbohydrates as a source of renewable materials and chemicals, unlike the hydrocarbons, which are actually beneath the earth surface, and we actually extract them, consume them, and add on to the carbon that is already existing. As against renewable nature of carbohydrates, which are grown above the earth surface. And what you are seeing to your right hand side of the picture is actually various products that are made from plants. Bioeconomy is then a knowledge-based production and use of all these biological resources to provide products, processes that are actually more sustainable, that are more environment friendly, that are self-sustaining. And if you can go to the next slide, what you are going to see is there are different principles on which this bioeconomy is based. And they're clearly keeping in mind the holistic health aspects, because as we know that, you know, the fossil fuels give rise to carbon emissions, more particulate matter. And we know that industry and transportation sector are one of the largest contributors of greenhouse gas emissions. Not only that, they give rise to higher particulate matter as a part of tailpipe emissions, which are health hazard. So the bioeconomy takes into account more holistic health aspect, because the combustion in bio-based fuels is more complete, being the oxygenating agent. Then, of course, there is this element of sustainability, that you are using the renewable resources. You are using resources which are everlasting and not finite. So therefore, renewable energy in the form of bioenergy has got tremendous importance. And over a period, the biodiversity is gaining importance like never before. If you simply look at, and then of course there is an element of robust development, which means the quality of education, reduce inequality, and so on and so forth. And all this is depicted on the right hand side of your screen through the origins of hydrocarbons. The point to be made here is that if you reflect on the climate disasters in last 2 years, by way of hailstorms, by way of excess rains, floods, heat waves, cyclones, you know, whatnot, we are clearly seeing that compared to the past two decades of the last millennium, these two decades of the current millennium have seen a sharp rise in climate disasters, which cause enormous amount of damages to the mankind, life, property, and it really pushes you back. So we all need to graduate to more sustainable practices, which is where bioeconomy kicks in. And those sustainable practices are to be used from renewable resources, which are low carbon in nature. And that's why the basic principles of bioeconomy in terms of holistic health, sustainability, and robust all-around development are very important. The next slide actually is telling you that on a bigger scheme of things, it is very important to look how bioeconomy actually facilitates the sustainable development. And we all know that United Nations Forum for Climate Change Council has come up with 17 sustainable development goals. And out of these 17 sustainable development goals, as many as 12 goals are achieved or are encompassed by the biomobility, by the bioeconomy. So in the bioeconomy space, there are several drivers. Sustainable development goals is the main driver. And then to augment that driver, there are things like Confederation of Parties Climate Change Summit, which was just concluded in Glasgow. The next one is happening in Egypt in the year COP27. Next year is in Egypt. The following year is in UAE. So we are seeing that the climate change awareness is spreading all around across all continents. And then there is Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change, which is mandating the nationally determined contributions for all countries to keep their carbon emissions low so that we can keep the temperature rise below 2 degrees. And that's where this race to zero campaign term is being coined. How quickly can you reach carbon neutrality is a point in discussion. Our Prime Minister at the COP26 agenda has announced carbon neutrality target to 2070, which is where the Panchamrut agenda is also tabled by him, where bioeconomy has a big role to play. And then clearly the other aspects being India's commitment to fulfill that, the challenges of global warming. On the next slide, what we are seeing is the bioeconomy per se is a huge topic. But for the discussion of this paper, we have limited it to the extent of the mobility, which is the transportation sector, and also the chemicals and materials sector. So the whole bioeconomy premise is based on the expertise of feedstock, which is F, different types of feedstock. You are going to see that in a minute. Technology that is developed to process that feedstock, and then you have variety of products. So if you look at this biomobility circle, which is actually a transportation solution in terms of low carbon fuels, it helps decarbonize the transportation sector. We are all mindful that transportation sector or the mobility is extremely important, be it surface, be it marine, or be it air, because they connect the generation and consumption points, whether it is goods, raw materials, commodities, finished products and whatnot, or even the people movement. So to decarbonize the transportation sector is very important, which is achieved by what we call as a biomobility platform. And then you are using, instead of fossil based chemicals and materials, using biological based chemicals and materials, call them biochemicals or renewable chemicals and materials in the form of bioprism technologies. And these are actually helping you recycle the carbon. Remember, I mentioned the concept of circular bioeconomy. So when you are using chemicals that are coming from biological route, you are actually not extracting anything from the mother earth, but actually only recycling a short carbon recycle. So without adding anything more to the atmosphere. So one hand decarbonization, another hand carbon recycling, both contribute to minimization of greenhouse gases. On the next slide, we take a little bit of a deep dive on this biomobility platform. And what you see in that slide is actually a variety of technologies that are shown in the green band, which are actually established by way of renewable natural gas, by way of first generation, that is sugar-based bioethanol, second generation, which is lignocellulose-based bioethanol, and biodiesel. But what's more is there is a great future to decarbonize the skies, that is the aviation sector, in the form of sustainable aviation fuels, biomarine fuels, biohydrogen. Indian government recently came up with a hydrogen mission, so which is the next big thing coming in the form of biohydrogen. And then there is biomethanol. So biomobility platform of technologies envisages usage of these bio-based feedstock to produce low carbon transportation fuel, both in liquid and gaseous form, for surface, marine and air application. The next slide quickly tells you what is renewable chemicals are. And renewable chemicals and materials portfolio is indicated by way of bioprism portfolio. Again, the biological resources, the left hand side shows you the process and the right hand side shows you the various application. All the materials and chemicals coming from bio route are less toxic, less poisonous, less harmful, environment friendly, and more often than not renewable. So if we quickly graduate to renewable materials and chemicals, we are going to be able to recycle the carbon instead of adding a new carbon. And all this, like I mentioned, is on the bedrock of feedstock technology and products. The next slide actually dwells a bit deeper into what is this feedstock technology and product. We have various types of feedstocks, which are sugary, starchy, lignocellulosic, and industrial waste streams indicated by in the pictures. And when they're put into series of technology solutions, what you're getting is different type of products or renewable chemicals material, including the biomanure. So what is coming from Mother Earth is going into Mother Earth in a short carbon cycle, which is keeping the carbon emissions under a good check. And this is where it is important to keep in mind that all this has a big role to play. And the next slide actually tells you these two frontiers of bioeconomy by way of biomobility and bioprism are actually create positively impacting environment, economy, and also society. In a country like India, where almost 50% of informal labor is involved into agrarian or agriculture based things, it is very important to create a sustainable revenue stream for farmers, jobs opportunities for rural youth, entrepreneurship opportunities for the rural youth, so that they are able to find livelihood in the farming side only. That will also curb the inrush of the labor migration from rural to urban areas. And obviously, we spoke a lot about how it impacts positively the environment. The economy aspect is also important, because we are dependent to the extent of 80% on the imported fossil fuels, namely crude oil and liquid natural gas. These cost exchequer a lot of foreign exchange. And with that foreign exchange, if we are able to actually save, we will be able to strengthen our currency, reduce our current account deposit, current account deficit, and thereby it will positively impact our economy, besides creating, strengthening rural economy, like I explained earlier. So the economy aspects are very, very important, just as social aspect. And finally, country like India, which is energy dependent on the external world, the energy security, energy self-realization is also very important. Remember, we said that the energy is growth engine for progress. India needs to go to $5 trillion economy. India needs to realize its dream of becoming a superpower. For it to happen, the need for energy is only going to go up. Need for automation is only going to go up. Industry revolution will only pick up. But for all that to be sustainable, we need to really drive the economy. And these are the frontiers. So in the last slide, we are just putting it together. I'm requesting Bhushan to recall some of the points is scored in the next slide, which are about the industry revolution.
Yeah, actually building on to the previous slide where we looked at environment, economy and social. Point number two is really about industry 5.0 enhanced version is a firm step in the direction to strike a balance between proverbial three P's, profits, planets and people. And as it were, it is building on the first point, which is Industry 5.0 enhanced version, taking the version 1 and 2 together in more sustainable, resilient and human-centric industry. So sustainable, resilient, human-centric and balance between profits, planet and people are two very key aspects of what we are presenting as the enhanced version of Industry 5.0.
That's right. And that's where it actually kicks in very important element of sustainable climate actions. I mean, energy optimization, energy conservation by way of improvements in the way we use our energy resources can only help us so much. But we have to pole vault to the next level. We have to take sustainable climate actions, which are only going to come through innovative technology solutions and greener sources of energy. And biofuels or bioeconomy is a big contender for that aspect. And which is exactly why we said that it not only impacts society, environment, economy, and also the energy aspect. So it encompasses really the three P's that Bhushan just mentioned earlier. And finally, for to the extent of this paper, we have limited to fuels and materials, and that's where the BioMobility and BioPrism platform are standing as two pillars. Indian government has declared a mission to become a bioeconomy, to become $100 billion bioeconomy, and in which these two elements have big role to play. We are just looking at 20% ethanol blending in gasoline right now. The concept of flex fuel engines, which means even higher blends of bioethanol in the gasoline, are kicking in, which will even to that extent reduce our dependency on fossil fuel. And the biochemical parts is only picking up because people want to go to environment friendly products, the products which are branded as green products, green practices. So I think this paper tries to merge the industrial revolution and harnesses it with the bioeconomy. And that's how we believe the future is. And our next slide is actually a typical thank you slide, which actually really represents what Bhushan was saying about confluence or convergence of robots and human activities for tactical and strategic purposes. And that's where we see future as going. So thank you very much for your time, attention. You've been very patient audience. I hope IEEE platform will be able to take our concepts far and wide to different parts of the country and the world. We welcome any comments, any thoughts, any suggestions, any critique so as to be able to continue to build on the research and work that we have put in. Thanks once again for the opportunity. Organizers of IEEE, MIT ADT University, we are thankful and grateful to you for giving us opportunity to shortlist and present our paper in this conference. And we also look forward to publishing this paper in the Explore Digital Library of IEEE. Thanks once again and namaste.
Thank you.